Hi, everyone. I'm Michael Edson. I'm the Director of Web and New Media Strategy at the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C. The Smithsonian is the world's largest museum and research complex, with 28 museums and research centers and a zoo, 139 million physical objects, 6,000 employees, and a global network of scholars, scientists, and subject matter experts. It's an amazing institution, but I'm not talking to you today as a representative of the Smithsonian. I'm talking to you today as a private citizen who cares very deeply in your mission, your goal of creating a civil society in the country of Sweden. And I'm also talking to you today as a plumber. That's right, you heard me. As a plumber, a guy who fixes pipes. I'm a plumber. My dad was a plumber. My father's father and father's mother were both plumbers. All of the Edsons have been plumbers all the way back into antiquity. It's what we do. It's what we know about. It's how we solve problems in the world. Let me show you an example. Today, I have a little bit of a problem. We had a hurricane that came through Washington last week, and it brought down a big tree trunk in my backyard, and I need to saw it up and get rid of it. So I'm going to get to work. Hold on just a second. Now, it's a good thing I brought my tools with me today, because I'm a plumber, I need to cut up this tree, and plumbers need tools. So let's see what we got here. Ah, this looks promising. I don't know what that is. Nope. No, looks sharp though. Nah. Wow, that's amazing. That's what I was looking for, a plumber's tool, because I'm a plumber, and I know how to do work as a plumber. So here we go. What was that all about? In the few minutes we have together this afternoon, I want to ask you a very simple question. Are you using the best tools to get your job done in society today? I think you have an incredible mission, an incredible vision of creating a civil society in Sweden, about empowering heritage as a force in the evolution of a democratic, sustainable society. That's an amazing concept. How are you going to get the job done? Back in the 20th century, without ever really deciding it, without ever circulating a memo and saying, this is how we're going to get work done, we formed a way of working inside these organizations, heritage organizations, government, nonprofits, education, business, and I'll call it the broadcast model. And the broadcast model says that you form an organization with a fixed staff and a fixed payroll and human resources and accounting and legal resources, and you put it in a box. And into that box, you put money, trust, reputation, collections, and expertise. And then out the other end of that box, you expect some outcomes. You expect something important to happen. And in our mission-driven organizations, you expect something extremely precious and important to happen out the other side of that box. And usually the way it works in the broadcast method is you get the experts in the middle to do the thing, to think the thoughts, to solve the problems, to manufacture the solutions. And then you deliver them down a one-way pipe to a passive and grateful audience. And that was a great method in the 20th century. That was the best we could do with the tools we had available to us then. The printing press, television, radio. This was a very effective way to reach audiences with a broadcast. But there are new ways of getting work done. And I think the physics of this new way of getting work done on the internet at vast global scale comes down to three new laws, three new rules of physics for how organizations can get big work done quickly in society. Rule number one, Joy's Law. Bill Joy was the co-founder of Sun Microsystems, and he famously said, "No matter what business you're in, most of the smart people work for someone else." Now, that's not an easy thing to say at a staff meeting, But think about it for a moment. Inside my organization, the Smithsonian Institution, we have 6,000 employees. Where is most of the innovation on planet Earth going to come from to solve the grand challenges that the Smithsonian devotes itself to? Is it going to come from the 6,000-person workforce of the Smithsonian or from everyone else on the planet? 7 billion people, the last time I checked. Chris Anderson from Wired magazine stood in front of a Smithsonian audience in 2009 and said, "Pick any object in your 139 million object collection. The person who knows the most about that thing doesn't work for you, and you don't know who they are. You can't even find them. But thanks to the internet, they can find you. And other people who know about that object can find each other." That's Joy's Law. And it really changes the way organizations need to think about expertise and broadcast. The second new law of physics is cognitive surplus. Cognitive surplus is the title of a book by Clay Shirky. And in it, Clay figures out that among the educated, internet-connected citizens of planet Earth, there are a trillion free hours of time available every year that can be used for some higher purpose. A trillion hours of free time. Clay notes that Americans use about 230 billion hours of that time every year. Doing what? Watching television. Cognitive surplus presents you with a tremendously powerful global workforce outside the walls of your institution. And anywhere you look, they're doing shockingly amazing things. The third law of physics is from a thought leader in social media by the name of Kathy Sierra. Kathy Sierra is a real inspiration to me. And Kathy tweeted in 2009, "I'm your user. I'm supposed to be the protagonist. I'm on a hero's journey. Your company, your business, your museum, your library should be the mentor or helpful sidekick, not an orc." Kathy says that in the old days, the formula was, in the broadcast epoch, the formula was, follow me, buy my product, visit my museum, because I'm great. I have the biggest marble columns in the city. Now, she says, the formula is follow me, buy my product, visit my museum, because I help make you great. That's a very different way of thinking about the power of an organization. Let me give you a specific example of how this plays out on the internet. This is the Smithsonian Institution's collection information website page for Spaceship One. Spaceship One was the first privately financed rocket ship to take a human being into outer space. It's the winner of the X Prize. It's a testament to human creativity and innovation and verve. And the Smithsonian Institution owns this physical object, Spaceship One. It hangs at the Air and Space Museum a block from my office. I can go and see it. If I'm resourceful, I can go home and find it on the internet. And I get this page, a little picture and some curatorial text. Very nice. But let's say I really want to know about this object. What do? I search Google, and I find the Wikipedia page for Spaceship One. And what's the first thing you notice? Hyperlinks. Hyperlinks. Dozens of hyperlinks. Hyperlinks about the individuals involved in the XPRIZE, about the person who flew the rocket ship, who designed it, the people who built it, about the astrophysics involved in the flying. It just goes on and on and on. Hyperlinks. Imagine trying to tell a story on the World Wide Web without hyperlinks. Does a Smithsonian curator, do your curators and subject matter experts have time to develop hyperlinked articles about every one of your objects, every historical site, every archaeological dig? No. But does everyone else in the world have that time? Yes, they do. This Wikipedia page has almost 400 editors. Imagine if your boss came into your office tomorrow and said, "We're going to create a new project, a new web page for this collection object, and I want to have 400 editors on it." You'd jump out the window. You would rather die than work on a project with 400 institutional editors. And yet, on the internet, because of this new physics, this kind of work just happens. And this article also happens to be translated into 28 languages. It's amazing. And if you look at Flickr, the free photo sharing website, and you search on the exact name of this rocket ship, Spaceship One, you find over 2,800 photographs of Spaceship One uploaded by users, by the people, with no central coordination or control, and tagged with exactly the name of the rocket ship. You have Spaceship One photographs of the rocket ship being launched, of it being built, of the people working on it, of people's Spaceship One tattoos. It's predictably amazing. And this didn't happen because some central authority said, we need to have more Spaceship One photographs. This happened because of this new physics of people working together without central authority and coordination on the World Wide Web. And some of the photography is amazing. We tend to believe that our experts are the only people who can create first-rate cultural resources. And yet, time and time again, among the 9 billion photographs, that's right, 9 billion photographs on Flickr, you find images like this that tell a complete story. And what is Spaceship One? Spaceship One is a rocket ship, and on YouTube, we can see it fly. So, which one of these resources tells you more about the world you're interested in? The Smithsonian's canonical collection information page, or everyone else in the world? There's really no competition, and it should make you ask the question, how am I going to accomplish difficult work at scale today? Am I going to manufacture everything myself inside my organization, or am I going to help other people be heroes? Am I going to help other people be successful outside my organization? Another example, Trove from the National Libraries of Australia, a national repository of digital documents that has crowdsourcing and collaboration built into the platform. Trove has over 314 million resources online. The last time I looked at that, it was just over 100 million resources. It's growing and scaling. And if you look at the side of the Trove website, it tells you about the human activity on the website today. When I looked at the website this morning, it said 80,751 newspaper text corrections today, done by citizens with no central authority or control. 80,751 corrections today. Can you get that kind of productivity from your staff? I don't think there's a heritage staff in the world that's big enough or dedicated enough or focused enough to do that kind of work day in and day out. Another example, Zooniverse. Zooniverse is a website, a platform for getting citizens involved in scientific research. It's a form of crowdsourcing. And when you look at Zooniverse, they have up at the top of the website the number of people active in the project. 656,481 people taking part worldwide. That's scale. Another example, OpenStreetMaps. OpenStreetMaps is, as they say, a free worldwide map created by people like you. People with expertise in their community, or their archaeological site, or their heritage collections, can contribute data to OpenStreetMaps and build OpenStreetMaps into their applications and websites for free. OpenStreetMaps, with little or no central control, has had 12 million edits and has created over 1.8 billion map nodes. And I'll correct myself. OpenStreetMaps hasn't done this. People like you have done this work. And finally, the last example I'll give to you is the MIT OpenCourseWare project. MIT OpenCourseWare was started in 2001 MIT faculty decided that rather than develop a for-profit online university for MIT, they would give away MIT's faculty teaching expertise for free. It was an outrageous idea, but over the last 10 years, they've served more than 100 million individuals worldwide. They've provided more than 2,000 courses online for free. They've seen no detrimental effect to the reputation and status of MIT. As a matter of fact, they've seen the exact opposite happen. MIT OpenCourseWare has created profound, unintended positive consequences for the student body, for MIT faculty, and for MIT's ability to be an educational leader in the 21st century. The MIT OpenCourseWare project's goal for the next 10 years is to serve 1 billion people. That's scale. That is work that matters. And I challenge you, as you're thinking about achieving your goals in society, can you reach that kind of scale? Can you reach that kind of scale? You will never attain it with broadcast tools. Broadcast is great, and there's still absolutely a role for the focused work of experts within an organization, but broadcast is an incomplete tool set. So, let's say you believe that this is really happening, and I think you do. I think Sweden has a number of very innovative, very impressive participatory heritage projects. Your participation in the Flickr Commons, your engagement with Wikipedia, your own search and aggregation websites, your participation in Europeana, the way you're reaching out to people outside your organizational walls who are doing excellent and important work is very impressive to me. But the question is, how can you make it scale? How can you really get this big win that you want in society by using these tools? And how can you change from doing the things you did in the 20th century to doing the things you want to do in the 21st century? And I have just 5 things for you to think about. The first is, take a hard look at where you're putting your resources. You have a remarkable spectrum of projects under your control. But are they well-fed enough? Are they nourished enough? Are you really stepping down on the accelerator and scaling, making big and powerful the ones that are working? Second thing to think about, are you looking outside your organizations for people exhibiting the kinds of behaviors you want to see more of in the world? Your organization now, your workforce, can include almost everyone on the planet. Are you looking outside hard enough and asking outside experts and enthusiasts how you can help them to be successful? Find those people and support their work. 3, recruit and nurture an excellent workforce. Absolutely the most important thing you can do. And this has been known to management science for probably thousands of years, probably since we were sitting around the campfire chasing mastodons in frozen Europe during the last ice age. It's been known that you need this talented, dedicated, driven bunch of people working with you. How are you going to find them? How are you going to motivate them? Are you focusing on this every day? And not just plumbers, as I talked about earlier on, but people who are capable of doing all kinds of work within and outside your organization. 4, focus relentlessly every day on what you're trying to accomplish in society. Every single day, measure progress towards those big goals. If you need more social media to build a civil society, then for heaven's sake, get more social media. If you don't bother. But measure progress on the big vision. Think about where you want to be a year from now and measure your effort and your progress towards that goal every single day. Most organizations that I've worked with who thought about progress in that way find that it takes months, not a year, to get the wins they want. And then finally, don't be happy being plumbers. Don't be happy just wielding saws either. You can't chop all the downed trees in the world yourself. You can't build and do everything yourself. Help other people to be successful. Make sure everyone in your society has the tools they need to build a civil society in Sweden.